Hello there and a very warm welcome to another edition of China's Beam. I'm Victor Mathias. Now, recent studies show that African startups have raised more in the first half of 2021 than they raised in the first half of 2019 and 2020 combined, where African fintech companies have raised more in the first 7 months of 2021 than they have in the entire decade before this one. But the ultimate goal for any startup is to solve problems, scale, gain global acclaim, and ultimately become a unicorn, a feat only a few Nigerian startups have achieved. Today on the program, we will be looking at how entrepreneurs can build startups, seek funding, scale, and become unicorns. And joining us to give a guide on how this can be achieved is a full-stack developer majoring in Ethereum, blockchain, DevOps, and machine learning. Jude Dike, he is the CEO of Get Equity, a company that has a sole purpose of making blockchain-based equity investments in African startups a reality. He joins us in our Lagos studio. It's a pleasure to have you today on the program, Jude.
It's a pleasure to be here as well.
Of course. We also have joining us from our Abuja studio, Sim Shagaya. He is the CEO and founder of ULesson, a Nigerian technology company on a mission to provide high-quality, affordable, and accessible education to all Africans. Sim, it's a pleasure to have you as well. Join us on the program today.
Today,
very well then. So Jude, kicks out this conversation for us. You know, for any startup, you know, starting, scaling, funding has to be like, it's a major problem. But it seems, you know, recent statistics shows there has been an inflow of funding into the country. But I mean, how important is funding, especially for startups when they begin?
I mean, we're still in Africa where quite a lot of funding is still very hard to come by. And Africa in itself is a very developing ecosystem compared to the rest of the world. You have the Asian ecosystem, you have the North American ecosystem, which is flush with cash, and you have the European ecosystem. Compared to that, we're like an infant in the cradle, right? And so far, especially with the couple of exits that happened last year and into this year, a lot more people are beginning to look at Africa as a new frontier. And I think we have in different ecosystems, or we have in different shades, where we have those who are looking at Africa from a more venture standpoint, and then we have diasporans, Africans who have been abroad for quite a while looking for things to put down back home. Before, it's a thing of you either send money to your relatives to build a house or to develop something or to do something agricultural. Now, a lot of people are looking that we finally have things that we can put our money in, and all I know is that I'm getting maybe 3x in 5 years' time.
Yeah, so what is the trend? Why is Africa now the new frontier?
I think it's been because of the recent major exits that have happened. So in the past 2 years, we've seen a few companies who have exited. I think Main One just sold just, recently. Yeah. Then we have Paystack, who was bought by Stripe. And I mean, in the world of fintech, Stripe is probably the biggest in the world. So for Stripe to say, and this is Paystack, who basically started out as being the Stripe for Africa, and then for them to be bought over by Stripe for $200 million is a really big deal. That in itself starts out a chain of events. Mm. And it's something similar we saw in Egypt with the sale of Careem to Uber. And now we have something called the Careem Mafia, which is a former bunch of employees from Careem who went on to start their own things and have raised funding or have become angel investors of their own. So you start to see when just a flush of cash can have ripple effects. Going over time.
Mm. All right, very well. Let me just hold you there for a bit and quickly go to our Abuja studio where Sim Shagaya is standing by. Sim, Jude has given us pretty much a perspective, as to how things are working, from Nigeria and even, to other African countries. But, I mean, you have been there, you've done that. And, what are the likely booby traps, that entrepreneurs are likely to face, when they venture into starting a startup?
Well, I mean, I think the good news is that things are much easier now than they were, say, 10 years ago. So there's real sort of institutional and VC interest on the continent. And I think even more importantly, there's local VCs and local early stage investors that are very active in the industry where that was just completely absent 10 years ago. I think for a Nigerian entrepreneur, I mean, being an entrepreneur in sort of these new fields of information technology and the new digital economy, it's tough enough already, but I think in Nigeria it can be especially so. And the challenges we typically face classically are around finding the right team. I think that's even more difficult than sort of finding the resources. Again, because we haven't had sort of, decades-long history in investing in our educational system, which is something I'm involved in now, as well as we should have. And, there is talent out there, but that talent is sort of self-trained. It's autodidactic. It's trained itself. You're going to find that talent is really, really scarce. This is the biggest challenge. And that's compounded by the fact that, the world has gotten very flat. The limited talent that is available in Nigeria, you're competing for that talent with startups from North America and Europe and Chile and all over the place. So this is a really, really tough one. And then, of course, classically, as Jude was alluding to and you've talked about, it's hard to find those resources still, even as an African startup. But that said, much easier than 10 years ago, much, much easier.
All right. So, I mean, it is interesting to me, that, back 10 years, like you said, it was mostly fintech, e-commerce and all of them, one which you founded, Conga. But now other tech aspects are getting traction. For instance, you talked about how you're playing in the edtech system. And of course, we know you Lesson just raised $15 million. And I mean, that's kind of huge. So What are you doing differently? I mean, what should other aspects of tech be doing differently to attract, all of the attention? Because as it is now, it seems to be fintech. What should others be doing, like you just did, to attract what you attracted?
Yeah, so I think that there is a tendency to kind of, how do I put this without sort of being offensive? I think that there is an over-concentration of the talent that we have in fintech. It's my personal opinion. And I do think that there are vast challenges out there across many sectors that we could be tackling right now. And I think you're seeing some of that. There generally is sort of a tendency, in broad investing to kind of one penguin jumps off the iceberg into one sector and everybody follows. I think that education, for example, holds out massive opportunity to create societal change and to build exceedingly large businesses. I think that exists in a whole range of sectors, and this is not to say people aren't addressing those. There are folks doing interesting things in healthcare and insurance and all of these other sectors.
Yeah, which was what necessitated my question, because I mean, it seems all of the attention is going to fintechs.
Yes, no, absolutely. I mean, I think it's because, as Jude alluded to, you've seen great momentum in that sector. 10 years ago, that momentum was in e-commerce. Everyone was doing e-commerce. But the savvy investors, the savvy entrepreneurs, I think, look for opportunities. Venture investing, by definition, is sort of going into the unknown. Yeah. You look for opportunities where no one has looked before. We are a bit of a first mover in the education space. And I think that produces an opportunity for sort of outsized returns. So, I'm really glad we're sort of a first mover. And, the indications we've seen from the few years we've been operating in this space is this is a really, really vast, vast market.
All right. So one of the things, that people, I am also, trying hard to, come to terms with is, when you say, oh, an acquisition has taken place or, someone has raised, funding, Series A, Series B, pre-seed and all of those things, one begins to wonder, so what is this money for? Because you hear all of that figure and then, you begin to wonder, what is one doing with that money when it comes with that funds? Where does it go to?
Well, I mean, I think in our case, it's really twofold. We are going to deepen the technology. There's a lot of technology that goes into sort of the elegant experience that we present to learners and the parents and the schools. But we're also going to be increasing, so ULesson is a bit different from, most companies. We have two stakeholders. We've got the learners, and then we've got their parents. And historically, we've really engaged with those learners. And what we're going to try and do now is really deepen that relationship with the parents, deepen relationship with the schools. Historically, we've also focused on maths, physics, chemistry, biology, the sciences. And now we're going to give full coverage to accounting and economics and government and localize those for Nigeria and Ghana. And then I think the final thing, and this speaks to your point, is that even though we see great trajectory, we see great momentum, we are creating a new market. We're shifting behavior that has been locked in for, you know, decades. So a lot of investment has to go into reaching out to the market, shifting the market, educating the market. Just like e-commerce is still very early, but now e-commerce is not so alien to Nigerians anymore. 10 years ago, it was completely alien. The people that told me it just couldn't be done. People would never buy and sell from someone they'd never met before. But vast amounts of investment went into that and shifted the market. So we have to do that for education now also.
Which makes a lot of sense because of what education stands, you know, what the standing education has in the society. But, Jude, you know, let me just quickly come back to you now. You know, in all of this investments, you know, funding, it seems to me there is some form of apathy towards women. What are the statistics as it stands?
As it stands, there's still less than 10% investment in women. So I guess the apathy in this case shows people trying to do, to make a lot more, I'm trying to be very, very intentional, a lot more intentional build up to getting more women in. Because, I mean, even from some credit companies, some credit analysis will give you a use case that funds being managed by women tend to have a higher return. Companies being managed by women tend to give a much more higher return on even investments for VCs.
Any of those companies in Nigeria that, you know, maybe any of the startups?
I mean, you look at PiggyVest, right? I like to say Odun, she's the CEO. She's probably one of the best C-suites I've ever met in a startup. And you can see from the numbers of PiggyVest, they're doing quite a lot. Right. There's also someone I met recently, Manuela. She runs a credit startup, and everything about from management to execution is really crazy. There's Tix.Africa, which is also managed by a woman as well. People are really doing things, and right now you can't really see the disparity in if it's run by men or if it's run by women anymore. And again, Odun and Eloho started out First Check, which is basically a fund for women, trying to bring more women into the VC scale, because it's still less than 10%. So even as much as we say there's apathy and everything, 10% is still quite a poor number compared to the rest of venture capital.
Yeah, so, I mean, what can be done to, you know, drive? I mean, I know you said, you know, they need to be more intentional. But, you know, what kind of support do you think the male founders and, you know, people like Cube, I mean, what kind of support can you offer to ensure that you have more women, you know, coming up and coming out seeking investments, you know, and doing so well like their peers as well?
Okay, so I would say the first is network effects, right? I think one thing that we've always seen, especially anywhere, it could be in finance, it could be in any criteria, you'd see a lot more men have this strong close ties between each other. And it's very hard for women to break through. I've heard some people say sometimes the best kind of deals are made maybe at 11 p.m. at night at a bar somewhere or whatever.
Over a drink.
Yeah, over a drink.
So, you know, just chew on that. Just, you know, hold that thought for a bit. I'll come back to you just to, you know, round up your statement. We'll need to take a quick break. And, of course, we'll be back to discuss more on this. Please stay with us. Thank you for staying with us. We still have with us our guests right here in the Lagos studio as well as in the Abuja studio. But just before we go to both of them, let's take a quick look at some of key points, you know, in terms of funding that, you know, has come to investments that has come to African startups in the past. So, well, just in the first three quarters of 2021, more than 300 African tech startups had raised more than $1.1 billion combined, the first time the sector has broken the $1 billion mark. Nigeria, Kenya, and South Africa lead the pack of African countries with higher startup funding, as they account for 28% of the startups that raised funds. Now, when it's time to raise money, African startups often have to look abroad. The U.S. is home to more investors involved in the deal in Africa than Africa in itself. Jude made mention of how North America has a lot of flush funds to spend on the startups. Of the tech unicorns currently in Africa, fintech takes preeminence, making 5 out of 7 companies. And African fintech companies have raised more in the first 7 months of 2021 than they have in the entire decade. And 4 of Africa's 7 unicorns emerged in just the first 9 months of 2021, a huge contrast to 2015 when there were no African unicorns. Now, there has been a significant decrease in the number of years it takes to become a unicorn for an African startup. The first 2 unicorns took 17 and 12 years to reach unicorn status, while the remaining 5 African unicorns took 5 years or less to achieve the same. Now, this figure keeps dropping as the 4 African unicorns that emerged in 2021 took an average of 3.75 years to reach a $1 billion valuation. Interesting figures, you know, but you know, so talking about these unicorns now, you know, what makes, you know, a company a unicorn? It's valuation. So I begin to wonder now, if you, like you made mention of Stripe acquiring Paystack. So what happens to the founders? I mean, they take this money and then what happens to them? Do they just leave the company, or what happens when an acquisition actually takes place?
So most times, typically the company doing the acquisition actually just buys out your sole rights, right? So they buy out your IP, right? But they still keep you to manage everything. So for example, Paystack's founding team is still there. They still have quite a lot of their employees currently working for them. Mm-hmm. And it's the same with acquisitions almost everywhere. Even when you look to the US as well, you see a couple of companies that have been acquired, they still maintain their CEOs, or sometimes the CEO gets bubbled up to the group company to now head a more wider breach.
Wider, okay.
So you start to see, like, when Facebook acquired WhatsApp, the WhatsApp CEO was bubbled up to now take control of, I think, everything chat or something like
messaging.
That.
Messaging.
Everything messaging, basically. So they still keep the entire team. It's usually rare to see a company acquire another company and then just do away with, let's say, everybody.
I see.
It's not in their best interest anyways.
Well, because they know the startup
more
than those acquiring it. But let me quickly go back to Abuja, where Sim is standing by. Sim, of course, you know, now that you have started receiving funds and all of that, the goal, ultimately, if you ask me, well, personal opinion again, is that you would want to reach that unicorn status. I mean, how soon would that be happening?
Predict, but what we do know is our trajectory is very strong. It's really fast. For a while there, you know, we launched into the lockdowns, and we thought, you know, the lockdowns were what was sort of was the wind that was carrying us, and we would, you know, that wind may go away. But even after the lockdowns ended and some normalization happened to the educational system, we continue to see super fast growth. So, you know, I'm sure it's going to happen someday. Again, if you look at the fact that we're a first mover, we have incredibly strong growth, and we have, you know, this vast market. You know, in Nigeria alone, 100 million people under the age of 18. Sadly, realistically, not all of them will, you know, get an education because of a whole range of factors. But it is sort of a very, very large market to serve. And more broadly in Africa, you're talking 600 million people under the age of 18 by the year 2030. So that's a really, really large opportunity. So it will come. For now, we're just sort of focused on serving one learner at a time.
Yeah, so which is, you know, going to lead me to my next question, because, you know, you talked about people who might not be able to get the education, but there are those who are willing to get the education, but as it stands, they are not equipped with the hardware and even the software to be able to, you know, be a part of this. How do you think that how do you think that bridge can be gapped? Because if you look at the fact that, you know, even the economic indices in some states, people can't even afford meals, not so to speak. Now, you know, there is that UN figure that, you know, you can't eat, that people don't have a meal, you know, to that standard. So if they can't even have a meal, let alone purchasing a smartphone and purchasing internet data, I mean, how do we bridge that gap?
Yeah, so I mean, I think that there's a tendency for us to look at some of these, to take one snapshot in time and imagine that that's how things are going to be forever. Things are changing very, very quickly. That's why you're seeing these unicorns being built. It's because of the underlying technologies are getting better and there's deeper penetration in broadband. There's deeper smartphone and tablet and device penetration. Look, I mean, you know, 10 years ago, or even just as recent as 6 years ago, the average African household spent something like 12% of household income on broadband connectivity. That number is down to 6% now, and it's trending down very, very fast. Now, we're not at sort of the 2% China-USA level, but we're heading there very quickly. You know, 10 years ago, it was only sort of the kids of the elite in universities that had laptops. Now in universities, laptop and device penetration has deepened greatly. Smartphone penetration is much deeper now. The point I'm making is that these underlying technologies, whether it's broadband or devices or some of all of these things, they will continue to become more affordable. They will continue to become more powerful. Yeah. Moore's law continues to march on. Devices become more powerful every year. You know, the U-Lesson app requires 2 gigabytes of RAM to run. In a couple of years, it will be, you know, even an entry-level device will be, you know, 16 gigabytes of RAM or something like that. Yeah. So, you know, I think we're going to get there. Okay. It's not to say things aren't difficult now. It's not to say that we can't sort of push more policies now to accelerate broadband and device adoption. I think government and policymakers have a big role to play, and that's a whole discussion we can have. But I think we will get there ultimately.
Well, I can't wait for us to get there, but I have to say thank you for joining us on the program today. Sim Shagaya, CEO of U-Lesson, you joined us from Abuja to share your thoughts on this.
Thanks,
of course. So, I mean, just round this up for us. I mean, your prediction, when would the next unicorn be coming out of Nigeria?
I think a lot of them are actually in the works right now. I think there's quite a few that a couple of people already have bets on. I think the first quarter of next year will be very interesting for the next set of startups who will announce, basically. Because I think pretty much some of them are already in talks and maybe finalizing checks, maybe already have their checks but not announced yet.
Well, we can't wait for that to happen. We can't wait just to see more unicorns, you know, from Nigeria.
Definitely.
Of course, but I would say thank you as well to you, Jude DK. You are the CEO of Get Equity. Thanks for joining us on the program.
Thank you for having me.
Well, that's where we are. We'll take a look now at the most viewed videos on our YouTube channel as we close the show. Thanks for watching. I'm Victor Mathias.
Entrant into the charts kicks off this week's list as banker and accomplice are paraded in Ogun State for allegedly carrying out a robbery attack.
With the help of members of the public, one of the robbers was apprehended.
It is followed in fourth by another new entrant, this time a university don, breaking down in tears as he blames the federal government for the UK-Canada COVID sanctions on Nigeria.
I'm deeply, deeply emotional. There's fever in my body. Rusted in my body. And I have to hold on to something to steady myself.
Third Sport sees the pandemonium that followed a truck accident in Lagos, where tears flowed and tensions rose as parents were searching for their children. In second place is a blast from the past that has garnered almost 2 million views in under a year, where a police corporal and others were paraded for alleged armed robbery and rituals.
We are doing our investigation. And by the time we conclude, we will do all administrative work that we're supposed to do on the two of them, and then move them, charge them to court appropriately.
While maintaining First Sport from last week is the gallantry of police officers who engaged gunmen in a duel which claimed 5 lives in Anambra State.
Don't fire from there. Don't fire.